So folks, just to introduce myself, I head the engineering team at Capillary Technologies. So we provide a cloud-based SaaS products to retail, large retailers and other consumer-facing businesses to engage better with their end customers. So we are present in about 30 countries at this point and working at a fairly decent scale. We touch almost 650 million consumers across these 30 countries and processing close to 15 billion line items every year, close to 3 to 4 billion transactions every year. And so we're working at a fairly decent scale. We're based in Bangalore, with a small dev center in Shanghai, China as well. Right? And thanks, Abhay, for that insightful talk. I think what caught my attention was that $18 per day that you are spending, right? So that's someone who's always looking to optimize my engineering expenditure. I think that definitely caught my attention, and I'll be reaching out to you to kind of understand slightly more in detail. Right? All right. Thanks, folks, for joining. So the agenda for my talk is going to be fairly straightforward. It's more of a 101 introductory talk on observability, just to, I'll probably take initial 5-10 minutes just to set a context of how this whole the whole drive and the concept of observability came into being in the recent 5 to 6 years, right? How the trend has progressed and what are the three core pillars of observability and how they tie up into the other related areas of monitoring, alerting as well. And also, I think towards the end, I'll probably spend about a couple of minutes on the recent emerging trends in observability space, like beyond the basic metrics monitoring and alerting. Right, and after that we can open up to questions and discussions with the audience. Yeah, let's just dive in. Right, so I think as many of you folks know, right, release to production is just the beginning of any of the life cycle of any software system of any product. Right, so there have been many studies in the past, and I think from anecdotal evidence as well, right, 40 to 90% of the total cost of software are actually incurred after launch. Right, so the maintenance, the keeping the uptime, keeping the performance healthy, pushing in bug fixes, patching, right? So it's a significant amount of cost that goes beyond just the production deployment or the first release of a system, right? And as systems are becoming more and more complex, more and more distributed, as rightly said by a very famous VC, that software is eating the world, right? So software is kind of touching more and more parts of our lives. The consequence of that is, as systems fail, the impact of that on our day-to-day lives is also becoming more and more prominent, right? So, and as systems become complex, they will fail, right? There's no doubt about it, right? No matter how hard you try to build scalable uptime systems, they will eventually fail, right? You towards the tail end of your availability numbers, right? The system will fail eventually, right? And as Werner Vogels, Amazon CTO, keeps saying, right, everything fails all the time. Number of failure points in a distributed system will increase with every new component you add to it. The more number of parts, the more number of request components and interactions are increasing, right? The more chances of failure you are introducing in your system eventually, right? So people say that, we can have a very strong monitoring framework, we can have a very strong monitoring infra on our systems to kind of alert us when some things are going wrong and we can just go and fix it, right? But the question that comes to mind is, what do you monitor, right? So I think that's where we'll probably just do a very simple case study. Again, something which most of you folks would be very familiar with, right? Let's just take an example of a very simple RESTful API server. You're serving REST APIs over HTTP, probably using JSON as your request response structure, right? What can be the potential points on which you would like to monitor? It could be your API latencies, 95th percentile average, 99th percentile. If you are running on containers or even on your VMs, your CPU usage, your load average, your memory swap. If assuming it's a Java-based application, your heap usage, your HTTP error codes, exception rate, failure rate, if you are dependent on external systems, and what are the latencies of external APIs, which could be impacting your application latency as well, and many, many more, right? So, I mean, these are just a few high-level sample points that we could potentially monitor on this API application, right? And you may want to multiply by the number of servers you are running, because for redundancy purpose, it's obvious, fairly obvious, you would want to have more and more servers running with the same API server code base. And if you are into disaster recovery and you want to have a backup colo, or you're running in a hot cold kind of a setup, you also have the multiplier of the number of deployments or number of clusters that we potentially have, right? So just a simple back of the envelope calculation will tell you that, you know, you are looking at not close to 400 to 500 or maybe even 1000 separate data points that you may want to monitor essentially, right? And this is just for one REST service that you could have at the top of your stack. There could be multiple such services in your overall software deployment that you have, right? So it's fairly obvious. Something does not look right, right? I mean, you can't have a monitoring system which is observing like thousands of metrics of across so many servers and applications running, right? I mean, you'll go crazy. You'll have to probably deploy a much, much larger team just to monitor and watch these metrics, essentially, right? So let's just step back and understand what monitoring is. Right. So in theoretical terms, what monitoring means is, you know, you're just capturing the state of a system to try to determine what is health of the system. Right. So a couple of methods that are commonly used is, you know, you have health checks running just to see whether the service is actually up and running. And secondly, can you send work to it? Right. So if you in the container ecosystem, you have the liveness probes to check whether your service is running or not. You have the readiness probes to check whether is the application ready to accept more work or not, right? And you could have metrics, system, application, and functional. We'll probably do a deeper dive into this in the subsequent slides. And once you have understood these health checks and metrics, you can define anomalies on it. Like for instance, if your latencies are going beyond a certain threshold, which you have set as per the acceptable number for your consumers, you can define an anomalous behavior on top, right? And alerts are usually set up on known failures, basically the things that you already know can go wrong, and you define a threshold on top of it and you define alerts on top of it, right? It's a fairly knowledge-based process. It's a reactive post-outage process. You have an outage, you realize that something was going wrong and your system was not alerting on it. So you end up adding an alert on top of it so that in future you can catch these anomalous behaviors proactively, right? But what about the unknown failures, right? I mean, you can always apply alerts on things that you already know could potentially go wrong, right? But as the complexity of the system is increasing, you're becoming more and more distributed, you're adding more and more integrations and external dependencies, the number of unknown failures are also increasing, right? So I think that's the time, you know, observability kind of comes into the picture very nicely, right? So observability helps you to kind of keep a tab on these unknown failures, essentially, right? So folks, I started my career way back in 2007 and 2008. I started working at Yahoo. So at Yahoo, the dev team had zero access to production systems, and the message that you see on the slide is something which I have lived through for almost 2.5 to 3 years. Once my code has gone to production, I did not even bat an eyelid whether it's running or not. Just hand it over to the DevOps team, let them manage the systems, even if it comes under fire. You know, it's a crash and burn kind of system. It's not our problem because devs don't have access to production systems, right? But in the last decade or so, the way the industry has progressed, the pace at which the developers are building software, this barrier between DevOps and dev is getting thinner and thinner, right? And this is one of the, I would say, you know, one of the very popular and remarkable posts by Copy Construct. I'm a big fan of her writing, right? So she posted this article in 2017. It's a highly recommended read, right? Observability is, you know, because devs don't like to do monitoring, you need to package it in a new nomenclature to make it palatable and trendy, right? So it's more of a lighter, it's a lighter take on what observability is. But yeah, in some form, you're essentially taking monitoring, keeping a system up and running, and the operational aspect of your infra closer to the developers in some form, right? Baron Schwartz, one of the well-known names in relational databases, one of the chief architects of Percona, and he also is the CEO of Vivid Cortex. I'm not sure if you folks have used it. Again, a very, very nice tool to monitor and keep your databases up and running. So he mentions it in a very, very clear and lucid way that monitoring tells you whether the system is working. Observability will help you understand why it is not working, right? That's why the whole, as distributed systems ecosystem is becoming more and more common observability is picking up at a similar pace, essentially. Right? So slightly theoretical definition, what observability is, it's a measure of how well the internal states of system can be inferred from the knowledge of its external outputs. Again, it might seem too fancy or too verbose, but the key items over here is, you know, you are trying to measure the internal states, and by looking at its external outputs, and you're trying to infer what's going on inside your application, right? So I kind of consider it to be, you know, fairly analogous to a medical diagnosis, right? A human body, to diagnose what's going wrong inside a human body, doctors just don't go and start opening up your body by, you know, by doing surgery and all, right? They try to infer what's going on inside your body by looking at the external output. It could be your blood pressure, could be your heartbeat rate, could be your temperature, could be your pulse rate, and all those external signals that your body is sending out, right? So essentially, observability of software systems is just an analog of that, essentially. You're trying to observe what's going on inside a software system by looking at the outputs that you're emitting from your applications, essentially. Right? So what could be the potential internal states of an application? Now, they're very, very context specific. For instance, if I'm talking about a web server, the internal states could be characterized as the availability and the uptime. Is the server actually responding to my requests? Could be the incoming request rates, could be my response latencies, HTTP failure rates. Application services, you know, it could be my functional success rates, failure rates. For message queues, it could be my queue lengths, number of active producer consumers at any point in time. Okay, so these are fairly context-specific states that you may want to define depending on your application architecture. And the key point here is that to measure the internal state, you will have to instrument your code while you're writing it, right? It cannot be an afterthought. So that's one thing I've seen very new engineers doing when they are writing code, right? They finish the whole application development when it's ready to go to QA or to move on to the next stage in the development process, they will start retroactively instrumenting their code, right? I kind of strongly discourage that, right? While writing code, think of that, is this a point where I want to measure the internal state of my application? If yes, instrument it, right? External outputs, that's where come the three pillars of observability, right? Metrics, logging, and tracing. So health checks is also a form of observability, essentially, but I kind of club it under metrics, but again, it's fairly hazy, so feel free to club it wherever you want. But yeah, for the sake of discussion, I consider it as part of my metrics chapter. Right, so let's spend a bit of time in each of these three pillars. Right, so what are metrics, right? So metrics are essentially nothing but the external state which you are measuring at a broad scope. Now, when I say a broad scope, it's nothing but a time dimension, because when you say metrics, you're looking at, you'll always look at metrics with the time as one of the axes. For instance, what was the performance of my APIs between 8 a.m. to 8 a.m. to 9 a.m. IST, right? Or what was the incoming request rate at particular slice or a bucket of time, essentially, right? So you will always have a time dimension or time axis available to you when you're talking about metrics, right? Could be system metrics. System metrics are nothing but your CPU utilization, your memory, swap, other network, other system parameters. Could be your application metrics, your success rate, failure rates, latency, the reports. Again, these are very application specific and subjective things which will be dependent on your application architecture and your design. And lastly, your business and functional metrics. These are slightly more relevant towards your business and your product managers, right? You're looking at your order rates. In case of payments, it could be an amount of successful forward payments, reverse payments, reconciliation requests. In case of couponing system, it could be the amount of coupons you are issuing, number of coupons which are getting redeemed successfully. Right? So again, business and functional metrics. So it's good to classify the metrics into these three buckets. They help you to kind of design those metrics better, and also to create your dashboards as aligned to the consumers and the stakeholders of these metrics, essentially. Right? Metrics should, what should be the criteria of deciding what to emit, what not to emit? I follow a very blanket rule of thumb, you know, be as generous as you want to be when emitting your metrics. If you want to get, you want to read some common guidelines around how you design your metrics, I'd highly recommend this article on metrics that matter. It came on ACM. It's a very RISE framework, how you decide whether this is a metric that you want to track or not, essentially, right? So be generous on metrics. However, be judicious on alerts, because again, you don't want alert fatigue. Going back to the point we are discussing in that simple case study, that you know, you don't want to alert on 1,000 different data points essentially, right? Your NOC team or your on calls will kind of go crazy with the amount of alerts you will be generating essentially, right? Another common mistake I have seen people doing is that they end up stuffing a lot of dimensions or data points on their metrics, right? So it's highly advised that your metrics should have low cardinality on the metadata that you're attaching to them, right? So avoid attaching user-specific IDs, order IDs, or entity IDs inside a metric, right? So metrics will always be providing you system summaries in some form, and they will help you answer questions like how many transactions failed, how many logins succeeded, how many orders are being processed, how many payments are being processed. So they will help you answer how kind of questions essentially, right? So that's another, a simple way to decide whether there's something you would want a metric on essentially on your system. Yeah. Common tools available to capture metrics: Prometheus, again, Webber touched upon it in a deep dive. InfluxDB, again, fairly popular tool. TimescaleDB, one of the recent additions in the last 2 to 3 years. Graphite is, I think, one of the old granddaddies of your timescale databases. Although I'm not a personal fan of Graphite, being the data model is very flattish and not very intuitive to people who come from a SQL-ish kind of a background. OpenTSDB, again, fairly old time series, time scale database, they runs on top of HBase. Scuba is again, a very nice architecture propagated by Facebook. It's a very nice paper, highly recommended to if you want to go deep into the algorithms that run, kind of optimizing the reach and write paths of a metric store. Apache Druid, people are using it for metric storing, but it's largely an event storage, event analytics, and Grafana for visualization, right? And one common pattern and common algorithm or data structure you will see in these metrics stores that they all use log structured merge trees, because metric databases are, metric stores are by nature supposed to be extremely, extremely scalable on writes as compared to reads, because you are writing at a much, much faster rate than you're reading it. So I think Webber also touched upon, you know, they're touching close to 900,000 metrics per second, right? So obviously the read would be of a much smaller scale than what their write scales are. Write throughputs are essentially, right? Coming to health checks, right? As I said, is my service running in container world? Liveness probes. Can I send work to it? Is my application ready to respond to work? Readiness probes. What are the different ways to collect health checks, right? So in a lot of P2P distributed databases, you would have heard the term gossip protocols, very popular in Cassandra and React. Whenever a node enters a cluster, it broadcasts its availability and health checks in a gossip protocol. Right, service registry. You service comes up. It's available to serve traffic. It goes and registers itself successfully. When the service is not service is going through a downtime, it will go. It will end up deregistering it from the service discovery, some of the service registry, and that's the way it's kind of propagating its health to the rest of the services in the system. And the older mechanisms and a lot of reliable mechanisms as well of doing health checks on via ELBs, HA proxies, Nginx. Again, they're very common and have been in use for many, many years, essentially, right? Coming to the second pillar, logging. So the way to understand logging is that, you know, logging helps you deep dive at a much smaller scope, and not on the time dimension, but rather on an entity dimension. It could be a request or a customer or a transaction. Logging will help you answer why kind of a question, essentially, why couldn't a customer place an order? Why did a transaction fail? Why did a checkout on an e-commerce application fail? Why couldn't I add a product to a cart? The scope is much, much smaller. You're not trying to aggregate things across a large number of requests. You're trying to look at or do a dissection of a much smaller request, essentially, right? Logging has to be centralized. Here comes the log collection and aggregation technologies, Fluentd, Logstash, and tons of agents available out there. Fluentd is a lot popular in the cloud native ecosystem. Logs have to be searchable. It comes to your indexing technologies, Elasticsearch, and whatnot. Index-free logging is also becoming quite popular these days. So Loki is the last tool that you see is picking up really well. So it has come into the Grafana ecosystem, and they're those guys are doing some really, really kick-ass job in kind of promoting the index-free logging ecosystem. And logs essentially have to be correlatable by a common key, even being in a fairly large distributed system, your request is touching multiple services. You have to tie the ends together and kind of arrive at a common trace of the request. So your request ID is like a very commonly used parameter. A lot of commonly available load balancers allow you can inject UUID as request IDs as soon as they enter your infra, simply. Right. So standard tools these days, ELK Stack, ESK paid technologies like Splunk and Sumo Logic and Loki, as I mentioned, right, a new trend in index tree logging is picking up essentially. Right. Anatomy of a log, very simple: timestamp, levels, service, commit IDs, build times, right? Build version number, region, customer ID, tracing, and all. Right. So having a well-structured logs helps you from day one to kind of get the maximum value out of a logging system. So many popular libraries allow you to define your appenders and your logging format. So it's a very, very common practice across multiple languages and libraries. Yeah. Third pillar, tracing. So tracing helps you to, so if you're working at a system, you're working in a software stack where you have multiple services, each service is responsible only for a very small component of your request processing. You may want to visualize it and you may want to trace what happened in what part of your request processing. Right? That's where the whole tracing comes into the observability space, right? And it actually became popular after Google published its Dapper paper, I think almost 10 to 11 years ago. Twitter also came up with an open tracing system called Zipkin. Then the community of developers got together, they published a standard called OpenJaeger, which again became very popular. And with a lot of your application performance monitoring tools like New Relic, Datadog, or AppDynamics, tracing comes out of the box, essentially. So it's a very, very useful tool for you to kind of zoom in into which particular component of your request processing is slowing down, how much time is it taking, and the whole concept of spans and traces comes into the picture. Right. So if you look at the observability spectrum, right, so you will have health checks and some form of metrics which are allowing you to catch known unknowns. And then comes your debugging and explorations space, where the other part of metrics help you to query to understand what went wrong. You're trying to discover the unknown unknowns, right? So tracing and logging kind of help you in the debugging and exploration part. Your health checks and some form of your basic health metrics help you for monitoring and resiliency, essentially. Right? We have discussed metrics, we have discovered logs, we have discovered tracing, right? But coming back to the problem we started with, what do you want to alert on? Right, comes service level objectives. One of the terms which has been popularized by Google's SRE teams a lot, essentially, right? So just folks, bear with me. It might sound too much funda. At least if the audience is fairly mature, it might seem repetitive. But yeah, for the newer folks, SLO is a very nice concept. I think it's something which I promote very, very heavily in my teams, right? SLOs are nothing but a very simple, quantifiable, and measurable goal for a service. And that goal should be linked to the user experience or the delight factor. Right? So as engineers, we take a lot of pride into building scalable systems. But at the end of the day, we have to think that there is a user who's trying to derive value out of the system that you have built. Right? So SLOs help you tie up the technical health and the technical factor of the systems to the user experience and the delight factor, essentially. Right? And SLO should be something which you are defining before you start writing code, right? You should work backwards, define an SLO first and then start writing code of your service, right? And have as few SLOs as possible and which are representative of your system behavior. You can probably get a more deeper insight into SLOs by reading through this article or looking at this talk on YouTube. Let's do a simple exercise on defining what could be the SLOs for, let's assume that I'm writing a cart service, right? So I'll probably open it up for comments from the audience at this point, right? Let's assume that you are responsible for writing a service which is managing the cart on an e-commerce portal, right? What could be the potential SLOs that you would define for such kind of a service? Maybe you can pour in your comments, you can pour in your answers in the comments, that works. Shall we open it up? I mean, if somebody wants to speak out, they can unmute. What do you want to do it?
Yeah. So as usual, as I said earlier in the previous talk, also folks watching, we have around 10 people watching on YouTube live stream. We have more people joining the second talk who are all here. We have heard your, thank you, Piyush, for such an insightful again talk. While this was more of an one-on-one, but sometimes, as you correctly said, right, you need to start from scratch. And there are always people coming into the practice new. They have to learn first principles way, right? Which is something we always talk about, right? Just doing fancy tools probably is always not great. You need to understand how to use that data more often in the right way to arrive at your decisions, right? So yeah, with that in mind,
I'll finish. I'll probably just take a few minutes, maybe just touch upon
I'm so sorry. I thought you were opening up for questions. I'm so sorry.
I'll probably make it a collaborative thing, you know, rather than just going to a monologue, right? Maybe just let the audience in.
Awesome. Sure. We can do that format also. So yeah, folks, you know, since Piyush wants it that way, feel free to, you know, have a conversation with him and interact with him. You can unmute yourself as he wants to. And you can interact as he, you know, would like to direct this. Please go ahead, Piyush. Sorry, I thought wrong. Apologies.
Yeah, no worries. So, folks, again, let's assume that, you know, you are writing a service or managing a service which does one of these three functionalities, right? It could be a cart service. It could be a authentication authorization service, right? Again, let's assume you have built a service like Okta or Auth0, or maybe you have built a gateway, communication gateway, right? Sending out SMSs, emails, push notification, right? So what would be the potential SLOs you may want to design for these kind of applications? So open for thoughts, folks. I mean, feel free to send us comments, or if you want to unmute and speak, feel free.
So let's say I will pitch in here, you know, since folks are still deciding on stuff. Like, I'll go for the second one, right? Auth and Auth0. Like, one important SLO here would be that out of, let's say, n number of authentication requests, how many are getting successful, right? And what is the latency of the auth, right? So those are sort of, you know, base metrics that we need to. And how many auth failures are happening? You know, they could happen due to wrong logic. They could happen due to unavailability of service. They could happen due to an edge case in the authorization logic, because more often authentication is a simple authorization is where it becomes, you know, much more complicated for people to actually plan out the whole workflow and execute, right? So those test cases, those edge cases, how we are navigating, that should be, you know, our SLOs for those two services, right?
Right. No, absolutely. And I think that makes a lot of sense. And the idea is that, you know, SLOs are essentially representative of what your service represents, right? So of what your service does essentially, right? So now, right, I mean, just going back to that HTTP REST example, right? My CPU spike can actually cause a high latency, which can cause a failure in my authentication authorization, right? So there could be thousands of reasons which can actually cause this behavior to kind of deviate from the expected norm, right? So, but having a tight watch on the expected behavior helps you capture multiple failures into a single metric, essentially, right? So having alerts on the SLO and the SLI objectives makes a lot more sense on a much on a very complex application, right? So having alerts around SLOs makes the job a lot easier, right? You can always use the deeper level metrics for analyzing and troubleshooting when the SLO is not getting met, but thinking of an SLO first approach helps a lot in, you know, in terms of designing your architecture, designing your alerting and monitoring infra in a much more easy and a consumable way, essentially, right?
Yeah.
So for a cart service, yeah, please go on.
Yeah, I mean, it should be like business metric driven, right? Like SLOs are mostly business metrics. And then you drill down to deeper system level stuff, more OS level stuff, right?
Right. Right. Similarly, for a cart service, it would be, you know, the number of products are getting added to the cart, number of quantities I'm able to change on a cart, number of successful checkouts I'm able to do. Right. So those are the SLOs on which I should be designing some of my metrics and essentially my alerts as well. And similarly, on a communication system, could be the number of successful SMSs I'm sending out, number of incoming requests, right, number of successful messages submitted to FCM or maybe SendGrid or some of those things. Right. Rather than worrying about my lower level nuances of the email payload sizes or anything of that sort, essentially, right?
Yeah.
And lastly, why should we spend time on observability, right? Obviously, for some of the really, you know, technical and operational aspects that you can build scalable systems, you can do better capacity and load planning, it leads to a lower mean time to repair. But besides that, you know, I've been running large teams for a very, very long time. One thing I realized is that, you know, having observability as first class citizen in the team, you know, provides a lot more data driven culture, right? All the conversations get driven around what metrics have you added? Do you have sufficient dashboards? Do we have sufficient alerts on the SLO? Right? So the whole culture kind of becomes a lot more data driven. Your teams are talking in terms of data rather than subjective terms like, is your service healthy? Can your service handle my scale? Right? And things become a lot more data driven, right? Your outcomes become a lot measurable and remove subjectivity in a sense that I have a bunch of architects on my group, right? I give them quarterly goals that here is a service which is operating at a 700 millisecond latency on 10,000 RPM. Your objective for the next quarter is to, you know, ensure that 10,000 RPM latency comes down to 500 ms. They have a clear measurable goal, no subjectivity, right? Someone cannot come back to me and say that, you know, I changed the whole data structure, I changed the whole algorithm, I optimized the code. If the KPI has not moved, essentially something has gone wrong, right? Either the hypothesis was wrong or maybe the implementation was wrong, right? Yeah. Similarly, it brings a lot more accountability across tech and product teams. I have had so many product managers come to me saying, our experiments are not working because the implementation is unstable, it is buggy, right? The way I solve it is that, you know, when the tech team rolls out, I ask the product managers to give me 3 KPIs which define that the implementation is successful. If those KPIs are met, the next analysis is completely on the hypothesis of the product, right? Was the hypothesis correct? Was the data analyzed correctly? Has the tech team delivered the feature in a stable way? So the product team can then go and conduct their experiment successfully. It brings a lot more accountability because you're talking data rather than subjectivity. There's no emotions involved into it, right? Pure data-driven conversations, essentially, right?
Also, it's, I think, very, given that how deep in the stack DevOps and observability is, it's very easy to lose track of, you know, that you are actually doing all of this for a very different product, right? It's not it's not about a single server, right? It's about what impact it's having. So having SLOs help us sort of prioritize the product thinking, right?
I think for me, you know, as an engineering leader and manager, for me, you know, the accountability aspect is something which is helping a lot by bringing in observability, right? So the engineering groups kind of commit to agreeing on a SLA or SLO numbers to each other, right? Let's assume I'm a consumer of the authentication authorization service. I can clearly go and tell them that, you know, I foresee a traffic of at least 5,000 RPM coming in the next coming quarter. Can you guarantee a 95th percentile SLA of 50 milliseconds to me so that I can commit 100 millisecond SLA to my consumer of the services, right? So this level of accountability becomes much easier when you have observability as part of your culture and part of your implementation, right? Talking about standards, again, given the plethora of, you know, metric tools, metrics collection technologies coming into the picture, the developer community came together, started defining standards which can be followed and technologies abide by. So OpenMetrics, one of the standards which came about 3 to 4 years ago, standardizing the structures of metrics, how do you emit it so that you can replace the metrics backend seamlessly. And OpenTelemetry is one of the recent standards which is getting a lot more adoption. It's basically a combination of the OpenSensors and the OpenTracing standards, right? So they have defined very clear APIs and SDKs to cover all the three pillars that we discussed, right? Metrics, tracing, context is nothing but adding more logging and annotation. So it's context is a generic broad term on top, right? And abiding by OpenTelemetry standards makes you, OpenTelemetry APIs are and SDKs are essentially open source. They're vendor neutral. So you tomorrow, let's assume you want to replace your metrics backend from Prometheus to something else, or maybe you want to move away from proprietary vendors like Neuralink or Datadog to an open source tool like Prometheus. Having an OpenTelemetry implementation will allow you to do that seamlessly, right? And it also avoids a lot more lock-in, right? You're not locked into a vendor and you don't have to commit to a long-term usage of a particular vendor, essentially, right? And one of the recent trends in observability beyond just application metrics monitoring and all is the data observability. This is something which I have started looking into in the last few months, right? With the advent of, you know, large data systems and companies like Snowflake coming into the picture who are actually, you know, making data analysis and analytics at a much, much large scale, very seamless and commodity. The data observability has also become a recent trend. The idea is, since systems are becoming more and more integrated, you're collecting a lot more data from multiple sources. The quality of data, the correctness of the data, the availability of the data, the freshness of the data has become a lot more important because your data teams and business teams need reliable data, right? They need to be, they have to be sure that the numbers that they are looking at, they are actually on accurate data, right? So a lot of startups have recently sprung in this space in the last 10, 12 to 15 months, right? Axel Data is an Indian company, Monte Carlo, Soda, right? They're actually building some really, really nice, good platforms for observing your data very, very closely, right? So the five pillars of data observability are, you know, freshness, volume, schema, distribution, and lineage. There are some reference articles you may want to read up, right? So freshness essentially simply means, is my data up to the date? Is my data 2 days old, 3 days old? Like, the data that I'm looking at, the inferences and analysis I'm looking at, are they recent or are they slightly stale, right? Volume could be, I expect to ingest at least 500 GB of data on a daily basis. Suddenly we see a dip by 200 gigs, right? So what happened? Is my volume reduction organic? Is my volume reduction could be because of a bug, right? Schema essentially means, since I'm connecting to multiple systems these days, a slight change in a schema or a JSON format in one endpoint could cause my whole data pipeline to crash, essentially, right? Ensuring the integrity of the schema across different integration touch points, right? Distribution means, again, how you're tracking the data pipeline. You have data coming in from multiple sources who are relaying and exchanging data on different APIs and through different steps in the pipeline, ensuring that whole exchange along the pipeline is healthy. Lineage, again, something very, very critical, especially for enterprise systems like what Capillary has, right? User's data is changing over time. A user is updating their profiles over time. How do you draw the lineage graph of that data, right? How do you arrive at the current state of a particular entity, essentially, right? So these kind of questions can be answered by data observability platform. But again, it's a fairly new trend. I would say not more than a couple of years old. So still a lot more innovation to happen in this area. But I feel with the increase of data systems globally, I think this is going to be a very, very popular or very closely watched trend in the coming years. Right? That's all, folks. Happy observing. And some of the references, strongly recommend folks reading it. Even if you are a matured observability practitioner, you know, running through these articles will definitely help. I kind of circle back to these articles every 6 to 8 months, to be honest. Right? Yeah, I'll open it up for Q&A. And if you want to reach out to me, that's my Twitter handle. Feel free to drop me a message anytime.